Rigid thinking, obsessive tendencies, special interests, all of these things tend to be associated with autism, and it turns out there is a unifying theory that explains all of them. And that theory is called monotropism. What is monotropism? That's exactly what we're going to talk about today. Hi there, my name is Megan, and this is the Neurocuriosity Club, the only YouTube channel that I'm aware of that is specifically made for people who think they might be autistic, they might be ADHD, but they're just not sure. Let's get curious about our brains together. Okay, monotropism. Monotropism is one of my new ADHD hyperfixations. I have been super into it recently and trying to understand its implications for better understanding the autistic brain. And I really think, and I am not alone in this, but a lot of people really think that monotropism is like the theory that explains autism. And I really love it. So first and foremost, credit where credit is due. The term monotropism was coined by Dinah Murray, Wen Lawson, and Mike Lesser in 2005, meaning it is a very new theory, generally speaking. Okay, so the underpinnings of this theory, the basis that it is built on, is the concept that attention is limited. It is a finite resource, whether you're autistic, ADHD, depressive, OCD, or neurotypical, it doesn't matter. Everyone's attention is, in fact, a limited resource. This, in and of itself, is a little bit radical, because a lot of neurotypical folks, in my experience at least, tend to view attention and focus as these infinite sources that we can just always draw upon. But the truth is, there is a limit for everyone. It's just that a lot of neurotypical people don't hit that limit on a regular basis, whereas a lot of neurodivergent people, no matter what your form of neurodivergence is, do tend to hit that limit a lot more often. The other main difference between neurotypicals and neurodivergent folks when it comes to attention is how we choose to harness it. You see, a lot of neurotypical people have what the creators of the term monotropism call polytropism. And Dinah Murray, Wen Lawson, and Mike Lesser came up with a really cool metaphor to explain the difference between polytropic thinking and monotropic thinking. And the metaphor went like this. Polytropic thinking is like a lamp. And when you turn on your focus or try to use that limited resource, it goes in every direction, but not necessarily super duper far. One little lamp like this is not going to light up an entire room necessarily, at least not the farther corners of it. Monotropic thinking, on the other hand, was much more like a flashlight, where when you turn on your focus, it goes in one direction and it goes much further than the lamp, but it doesn't illuminate as much space. Now, I know a lot of you watching are autistic, and a lot of autistic people are not fans of metaphors. Personally, I am, and I think a lot of us are, but a lot of us are not. So if you're not super metaphorical, here is what the lamp flashlight metaphor means. Basically, if you are a polytropic thinker, your concentration is less focused, it's more broad, and that allows you to explore more things, just less deeply. And if you're more of a monotropic thinker, your attention tends to be much more focused, much more pinpointed, and that means that you can't focus on everything, but when you do focus on something, you go pretty deep. So, how does this fit into what we know about autism? Let's go back to what I mentioned at the beginning. We talked about rigid thinking, obsessive tendencies, and special interests, all of which are related to monotropic thinking. So let's start with rigid thinking. Rigid thinking is a cornerstone of autism. It's basically the idea that a lot of autistic folks tend to think in black and white, yes or no, all or nothing. When we make plans, we expect to stick to those plans. And when plans change, even when really small aspects of the plan change, we have a hard time coping with that. Now, the theory of monotropism would say that that's because of something that Tanya Adkin calls monotropic split. P.S. Tanya Adkin, who created the terms monotropic split and monotropic spiral, which we will talk about next week, is speaking in the Neurodivergent Clubhouse. Yes, I got her to come speak. She's going to talk all about monotropism. So if you're interested, go to the link in the description. I'm letting people sneak into the Neurodivergent Clubhouse. Usually doors are closed right now, but I don't care because I want you to come see Tanya speak. She's speaking at the end of May. So, okay. There's that, my little side note. But anyway, monotropic split is basically when multiple things are pulling on that flashlight beam, trying to get it to separate, but that's not how our minds work. So what this does is it causes an intense amount of distress. So when really small things change or really small things pull at our attention and we're unable to pull our attention away from what we're currently focusing on, it causes a lot of distress and a lot of panic for a lot of us. One way that I like to think about it is that a lot of autistic folks are convergent thinkers rather than divergent thinkers. Put very, very simply, divergent thinking is when you come up with sort of a question, a central thesis, a what if, right? And then you come up with all of these potential answers that you can explore, right? And it diverges from the question. Convergent thinking, on the other hand, is basically when you say, here's a fact, here's a fact, here's a fact, here's a fact. All of these facts come together to create this answer. And I think a lot of autistic folks and a lot of monotropic thinkers in general tend toward convergent thinking. Now, this doesn't mean we can't be creative. There is a bit of a stereotype in the world of divergent versus convergent thinking that divergent thinking is more creative and convergent thinking is more logical, but I think that's a little reductionist. Because I have experienced monotropic thinking and convergent thinking firsthand in the way my brain works, and believe me, it can be incredibly creative. You would be amazed at the number of supposedly potentially unrelated facts that I can draw into one singular conclusion. Which leads me to obsessive tendencies. This is a really big thing for a lot of autistic folks. We tend to get really, really stuck on stuff. We're not just interested, we're not passionate, we are often obsessed. There's actually a really great word for this, also coined by the one and only Tanya Adkin, and that is monotropic spiral. As I mentioned, I'll talk all about my personal experience with monotropic spiral next week, but please know that it is a deeply unpleasant, unsettling, and sometimes even dangerous experience. Moving on to the next area of autistic monotropic thinking, and that is special interests. The flashlight in our minds shines a spotlight on our special interests. We cannot look away. It is enamoring. We fall in love with our special interests. We absorb and absorb and absorb information about it like an infinite sponge. Because yes, attention may be finite, but love is not. And finally, I also want to talk about repetitive behaviors, because this is one of the diagnostic criteria for autism, and I think it also relates to monotropism. You might be wondering, okay, how are repetitive behaviors linked to monotropism? But I think the connection, and many other researchers think this too, this was not my original idea, but a lot of people believe that when we are experiencing monotropic split, which I mentioned earlier, too many things pulling at our flashlight of attention, right? Too many things are pulling at it. We attempt to take all of those distractions and funnel them into the flashlight. How do we do this? Through controlling what we can control, which tends to be our behavior. We repeat and repeat and repeat as a way of basically digging a hole straight down in one direction, creating gravity to draw all of those split attentions in one direction. For example, when I'm really stressed, I tend to rock back and forth. A lot. And I've never really thought about why I do this. Oh my gosh, this is like very soothing. Anyway, I've never thought about why I do this, but I definitely think it's because it forces me to focus on the way my body feels in space, as opposed to thinking about the like 9,000 things I have to do and all of the splits on my attention. I am just, right now, I am focused on the back and forth and the words I'm saying, and that's it. And it is really glorious. Okay, so if you want to learn more about monotropism on your own, I've included links to all of the resources I used to create this video in the description. Plus, I've linked to the monotropism quiz, which is a quiz you can take that sort of scores you on how monotropic your thinking is, which I found super helpful and super interesting. And finally, if you're looking to work with someone who understands monotropism, who understands what it's like to have a flashlight kind of mind, I am a auDHD coach. I would love to work with you and to talk about how we can get your monotropic brain to do what you want it to do and how to work with your monotropic tendencies instead of trying to be a polytropic thinker when you're just not. The link to book a discovery call with me to find out if we're a good fit to work together is also in the description. Have fun checking out all of those resources, and I will see you all next time.